Assalamu alaikum, hello and welcome to The Health Show Live, here only on the Islam channel with me, Alistair Greener. The Health Show aims to cover all matters concerning your health and to keep you informed and healthy by discussing a range of topics. We do encourage you at home to call in as well and talk to us about these very issues because we'd really like to get your questions answered. But we must stress that should you suffer from any medical problems, it's always highly recommended that you contact your doctor or GP, as The Health Show gives you an alternative viewpoint to the health concern being discussed. Now, if you'd like to speak to our expert today, the number to call will be 020 7374 6423. But please don't call just yet, as the lines will be open later on in the show. You can also email us at healthshow@islamchannel.tv. Today, we're delighted to welcome Dr. Nihal Abosaif, a consultant in acute medicine from the University Hospital of Coventry in Warwickshire. Dr. Abosaif specialises in stroke and cardiac services, as well as nephrology, which, if like me, you didn't know what it was, it's the term used to describe diseases associated with the kidney. She's also an educational lead in teaching acute medicine. Thank you very much indeed for joining us.
Thank you.
And we look forward to talking to you a little bit more in a while. But before we do, let's see how a psychiatric hospital in Belgium has stored almost 3,000 human brains of the mentally ill, epileptic, and people with Alzheimer's. Now, these are then used in research for people with depression or schizophrenia.
In the basement of this psychiatric hospital in Belgium, visitors are met with a gruesome sight. Here, there are almost 3,000 human brains, the biggest collection in the world, taken from the mentally ill, epileptics, people with Alzheimer's, and even boxers. It's a scientific treasure chest, to be used for research into illnesses such as depression or schizophrenia.
Nowadays in Belgium, it's really hard, if not almost impossible, to get your hands on actual tissue of patients after they have deceased.
The collection was started in 1951 by a British doctor and was almost lost because of a lack of storage space in London. Now transferred to Belgium, each pickled brain comes with its own medical file, kept up until the death of the patient.
These brains of the collected in the 1950s and early 60s are from patients that never got in contact with these drugs. So that makes that we can investigate brains of psychiatric patients that have only suffered from the illness and have not had the impact of these drugs.
This is a whole human brain.
The brain is the body's most well-protected organ, and therefore the most difficult to get to and the hardest to study. This makes the collection all the more important.
We are looking at whether inflammation in the brain can cause or worsen or influence in some way the disease course of several psychiatric disorders.
Just one of the questions the team is hoping to answer in the months to come.
That was absolutely fascinating, and thank you again for coming on the show, because what we're talking about here is very much associated with the brain. But first of all, I would like to talk about acute medicine. What exactly is acute medicine?
So acute medicine is a new specialty which has been introduced to the UK for the last 10 years, and it has been serving really well to save the hospital from the hassle of seeing like very unwell and sick patients who come through the front door. So we are actually seeing patients at the front door in the hospital, same like the accident and emergency. We work like hand in hand with them. We do sometimes shifts in the A&E department. And my hospital is like the tertiary center in Coventry, which we can see up to 650 patients per day. And one third of them is medical patients. So we nearly admit about between 80 to 100 out of 200 we see in total.
And of course, when it comes to acute medicine, the brain is obviously very much a part of that. And I know the brain is associated with strokes and so on, but
of course,
tell us exactly what a stroke is.
So a stroke is the sudden, and it has to be sudden, and that's why it's called a stroke. It's like a hit. So it's sudden cut of blood supply to the brain, and that will present with different symptoms, which I'm going to talk about later.
We'll come to that. But let's have a look at the brain in our first. We've got a couple of slides here.
Just before the slide, the second definition of the stroke, which now the British stroke association, they like to call it stroke, not cerebrovascular accident, which they used to call it before, because, as I said, because of the acuity of the stroke and also how it should present to the hospital.
Okay. So let's have a look at what's actually going on in the brain. Sure. So tell us what's happening here.
So what's happening here is I brought that slide specially to show people that the brain is quite a complicated structure, as we know.
Yeah.
It's how we move, how we think. So the areas of the brain is the areas which will be affected by a blood clot or a bleed inside the brain, and that will show the symptoms according to the function of these areas. So if we can see here on, can we go back? Sorry,
so
previous
just
slide.
Just go back. Yeah.
So that picture on the left-hand side is like the outer surface of the brain, and the picture here is the inner surface.
Right.
The outer surface, the biggest area, which is like this pink part of the brain, is the area of the motor part of the brain, which controls our movement, our thinking, the speech. The area which is slightly purple, this is the sensory part of the brain. And the green part is the thinking part of the brain, or what we call cognition. So some people can sometimes present with confusion rather than weakness or sensory loss, and that can confuse some people.
And again, as you say, we're going to talk about the how a stroke will present itself in a while.
The last part of the brain, the orange bit, this is concerned with the vision. So any stroke in this area can cause complete loss of vision. And it has to be sudden to diagnose.
And a stroke can happen in any part.
Yes,
any part of that. Okay. Well, I know our next slide looks a little bit more at the brain, areas of the brain.
So these are the areas I explained before. So motor part, sensory part, thinking part, or intellectual or emotional part, and the balance and the vision on the back of the brain. And then the brain stem is the most vital area of the brain, which any stroke in it actually is quite fatal, can lead to sudden death rather than it doesn't really have
some
time to
thing.
Present.
And again, we'll talk a lot about the symptoms and how you are with that. Now, I know from what we said, there's two main causes.
Yeah.
One is lack of blood supply getting to the brain, and then something on the brain. Mm. Let's have a look at the lack of blood supply getting to the brain first.
Yeah.
What's happening here?
So that's the main artery supplying the brain. It's coming from the neck. So obviously, the heart would be the main source of the blood, and the heart gives us the biggest artery of the heart, which is the aorta, and the biggest branch of the aorta is called internal carotid artery, which goes inside the brain, and as you can see, it gives the branches to different parts of the brain.
So this type of stroke is when there's a blockage to that. And okay, so that's one way that it can happen.
Of course.
And the other way, which I think is on the next slide,
if there is a bleed
on the brain. Yeah. I think that's our next slide there.
This is a bit of like how the artery goes inside the brain and branches into different areas. And then the next slide, this is the area at the base of the brain where congenital anomalies can cause like some dilatation of the arteries of the brain, and when they rupture because they are weak, they cause a bleed. So this is the other presentation of the stroke.
So let's say either of these two happen and they present themselves. How easy is it for you to diagnose what's actually going on in the brain, what type of bleed it is?
Sure. We'll talk more about the ischemic stroke or the thrombotic one, secondary to the clot, because that's more common. So if you want to divide the types of the stroke, we have, as I said, like a clot or a bleed or something affecting the back of the brain. Let's say about 70% is secondary to clots, which is most common. So always our statement in medicine, what's common is common.
Go for the most common,
Now,
this is obviously clots which are happening.
So this is how the clot is happening. So there is thickening of the artery, and as you can see, it starts to narrow. Yeah. And then at one sudden event, you know, a clot will develop, and this is when a sudden a stroke happens.
And but there's no, is there any indication for anyone to know that, that those, as you can see there, the flattened deposits,
yes.
Is there any way, any indication someone will know before it happens?
Of course, yeah, which what we call transient ischemic attack, or what people say mini stroke. So people can present with symptoms exactly like the stroke, but then it resolves within a few hours.
So, this is where the blood is trying to get through.
Yes.
It just manages it,
yeah.
So it doesn't block it completely.
Yes.
Right.
And, or there is a small clot which dissolves later on because God, you know, just want to show us that, you know, something is really
take
wrong.
Take notice, yeah. Here. Yeah.
So just it's like a clue. Take care, you know, try to change your life and, you know, go on. So actually, a lot of people...
Well, let's talk about that, yeah. A little bit, you know, in terms of prevention.
Sure.
To stop that hardening of the arteries, to stop those deposits.
Yeah.
What are the sort of general things that people can do? I mean, obviously there's some hereditary factors maybe in there, but in terms of what we're in control of, what can we do?
Yeah, sure. Most of the causes are causes which we do to ourselves rather than...
So lifestyle causes.
Lifestyle causes,
yeah.
Or what you call risk factors. So the risk factors for stroke are high blood pressure, diabetes, smoking, high cholesterol. So all really the bad stuff we do to ourselves. So the high blood pressure, some of it can be hereditary, but most of the causes of high blood pressure is because of eating high salt, not doing exercise, really the sedentary life we live in, you know, using the remote all the time. And
so and again, we've got a few factors here.
So obesity is the main cause, obviously, of both high blood pressure and diabetes.
And you can, I'm assuming, again, you can check some of these things. So you can get a cholesterol test, you can check your blood pressure. So the indication should be there.
I think once we hit the age of 40, we should be more careful about our health. Although that now we can see actually younger patients who come with a stroke because of obesity. And, you know, that lifestyle now is really bad. You know, people eat a lot of sugar and fat, and they don't really look at the healthy food.
And these
food.
Are all the things.
Yeah.
So let's now move on to the symptoms of a stroke, because we've been seeing a big campaign from the National Health about recognising, and it's called FAST. Talk us through what we should do if we see someone presenting with these symptoms.
So the FAST also has been introduced a few years ago to make awareness to the public about the common symptoms of the stroke, which can be in the first stages, as I say, what we call the TIA or the mini stroke, or it can lead to a proper stroke. But it means really it's an urgent thing which has to present to hospital rather than GP. So don't go to your GP when you have these symptoms. So if we go through the symptoms, we have the face droop, okay, which is the F, stands for the F, and then the arm is the arm weakness. This is a picture of how the face, it's always very obvious in the mouth mainly, and the arm will be weak or numb. And the S is for speech, so people cannot talk. Like they have the words in their mind, but they can't really get it out. So T is for time, which means you have to call the ambulance immediately, because time is really what we call time is brain, which means if you call the ambulance quickly, you save more cells of the brain rather than if you wait like for an hour or two or call 111 or call your GP, because that will kill more
And is there anything that you
cells.
Can be doing while you're waiting for the ambulance? For example, you know, we know if someone's had a heart attack or something, you can do things. But is there anything with a stroke that you can do?
It's difficult to say, because I don't want to advise people to take aspirin or do something wrong, because when you have a stroke, you need to have a scan immediately. And actually, now what we say is the time from home to the needle, which is the needle is what I'm going to talk about, the immediate management of the stroke, which is called thrombolysis or clot busting. The ideal time is half an hour. So you can imagine it's quite an urgent thing. And now they can send even air ambulance to take people to the hospital.
Which is why FAST is so important, because if you can identify it's a stroke, you can tell the emergency services that's what it is.
Correct.
They can then take immediate action.
Of course. So the new treatment now for the stroke is thrombolysis. So once patients present with any of these manifestations, as I said, the FAST, so they call the ambulance or the paramedics, they confirm the diagnosis to us, they call us, we have special phones in the hospital.
I think we've seen that on the TV, the red phones, yes.
It's similar to that.
Yeah.
So when they call us, we know that there is a stroke patient is coming, the whole team goes to the accident and emergency and wait for the patient. As I said, it can happen anywhere in the country. They actually now choose which hospital can do this thrombolysis. So because this is a specialist service, which you need also further follow-up after admission, you can't really send the patient to any hospital. So there are hospitals which have a stroke service or what we call hyper-acute stroke
unit. And what
will
you actually do when the patient arrives? What's the immediate thing that you as a specialist will do?
First thing is we take the patient immediately to the scanner, do a CT scan. And then the doctor examines the patient very quickly. In 5 minutes, we do something called NIH score, which a special score has been produced by the National Institute of Health in America, but we still do that here. And it's like a scoring system to the degree of the stroke severity. So according to this stroke severity plus the CT scan, we can know exactly how fast we can give the thrombolysis and if it's going to be effective or not. And the reason to do the scan, because if there is a bleed, which, as I said, can present exactly same to the clot, you will not be able to know until you get a picture. So we need the scan to be done. So if you exclude the bleed and you know this is a stroke, so you can give the thrombolysis because it's a very strong injection that will send the blood immediately. So if there is a bleed, you're going to cause more damage. So that's why this is what I'm saying. We can't really do anything in between until
you know exactly what it is. But the most common form is the lack of blood getting to the brain in the first place.
Correct.
That's the most common.
70% of cases secondary to that. And as I said, we'll do the scan. If the scan doesn't show a bleed, we give aspirin and then we give this injection, which takes an hour to work. And I've seen really miracles after giving these injections, like people after they were completely paralyzed, they start to move their arm. It does improve the prognosis. It doesn't like 100% reverse what happened, but at least it improves the rehabilitation, which we're going to talk about.
Talk a little bit about the rehabilitation now in terms of somebody's had a stroke, they still do have some difficulties moving their arms, maybe their speech is still slurred slightly and so on.
Sure.
What's the sort of, obviously it'll depend very much on the individual and the severity of the stroke, but what will be the normal kind of physiotherapy or help that's provided after the initial assessment?
Of course. As I said, it depends on how the patients presented first. So if they are coming mainly with a clot affecting the upper part of the brain, as I said, the frontal area or the anterior part of the brain here, this is affecting mainly the power. So people will lose power in the arm or the leg. They might lose their speech. The sensations will be also affected. As we can see here in this picture, this is nearly like half of the brain has been lost, but that's a bit of a late presentation.
Right.
So this patient has presented after a few hours of having the stroke. That's why we can see that nearly half of the brain is started to be black, which means death of the brain cells.
And once that's happened, there's nothing you can do to get it back. That's permanent.
Yes. So That's why I'm saying it's an emergency. If we can get it within 4 hours, which is what's recommended by the NICE guidance, yeah. You know, the NICE guidance, it's like this national guidelines
we have. And again, I think people are getting this message, hopefully,
of
that
course.
Speed is absolutely element.
It's
so what's we looking at here?
This is also another stroke on the left side of the brain. I'm showing just both sides because it depends which dominant hemisphere or part of the brain affecting us, because we're all right-handed, or most of us right-handed. So our dominant brain part is the left side. So if you have a stroke on the left is much worse than having a stroke on the right side.
Right. Okay.
Even that the right side might be bigger, but because the right side does not really affect us like the left side of the brain.
So we've got the right side here.
Now this is the bleed. So as you can see, it's a bit different.
So this is the 30% of people this might affect. And this is
so
a natural bleed on the brain.
Does show this white patch, which means blood.
And that's blood, okay. Yeah,
which is quite a big bleed as well. And that's on the left side as well.
So and again, this is the whole point of doing the scan as quickly as possible
to know
so you
what's
can see
going
all
on.
This. Right.
So if we go back to the first initial management, so I said we give the thrombolysis, we give aspirin, we have to check the swallowing, we have to check the speech, and then they go to a special unit called hyperacute stroke unit, which will follow them up for the first 3 days, make sure they are stable, blood pressure is fine, and then swallowing is all right. If they can't swallow, we have to put a tube into their stomach to feed them. And after that, they start the rehabilitation. We can't start rehabilitation immediately. I mean, like, not from the first 24 hours. We start it, like, about 2 to 3 days after until everything settles down.
So you've got everything to stabilize.
Yes.
And then we've got a picture here of some of the...
Yeah, so the rehabilitation is the mainstay of the long-term management, because these people will have, obviously, disability. So either they will have a paralyzed arm, paralyzed leg, they might not be able to talk for like few months, or some people do not talk
at all. So how long can these,
so
the rehabilitation, how effective is it, and how long can people get back to normal? For that matter, can they get back to normal?
So it depends on the brain insult which happened originally. Mm-hmm. So can we just take that out? This is the brain, the kidney part.
Okay, so we'll come back to that in a moment. But so the...
So with the insult of the brain, so if for example, like half of the brain cells have died, this means the rehabilitation will take a longer time rather than quarter of the brain cells or like a small part of the brain.
Yeah.
So it depends on the blood supply and the severity. So for example, like if for the picture, we've seen like half of the brain which was really infarcted or dead. These people will have long-term disability. It's very difficult for them to come back to normal or walk or have a normal life. They will be disabled.
And will you be able to tell that from the scan?
Yes.
So you'll be able to tell a patient what their chances are of making
course.
Full recovery, partial, or no recovery?
Correct,
And proportionally, what are the sort of percentages these days for people to make a full recovery?
With the new treatment, with the thrombolysis, the improvement in recovery has really become quite relevant now. So about 50% of people who have stroke can go back to normal, while...
Well, 50%.
Yeah, it's really improved from before. So before, actually, there was no treatment stroke. It was like a deadly disease,
you know? I presume this is a combination of us maybe reacting, getting people... to have their treatment quicker, and then, as you say, for the treatment itself becoming more effective.
That's true. And also, as I said, the clue which God gives us about this mini stroke, which a lot of people present with like slight weakness of the face or the arm or the speech, and that resolves within half an hour or an hour. So we know that there is something wrong with their blood vessels, which, as I've seen in the picture, there was like a clot in one of the blood vessels in the neck. So we do a scan on the neck called Doppler or ultrasound scan, and that can show us exactly if there is narrowing. And then these people are referred to surgeons, and the surgeons do an operation to remove the clot out of the neck.
Let's just say that, because there must be a lot of people watching who are thinking, I'm not sure whether I did have a symptom or not have a symptom.
Right.
You know, some of the things that you're talking about are vaguely familiar.
Yes.
If people are at that end of the spectrum, what are the sort of things that they should be doing if they're in a slight doubt? They haven't had anything major, but there's something there. What do they do?
They have to go to their doctor, to their GP, of course, as long as they do not present with the first symptoms. Okay,
of course.
As I said, first call ambulance immediately. But if you just have a twinge
or just something doesn't feel quite right.
A little bit different because like numbness is not part of the fast. Some people get a little bit of numbness in the arm, loss of vision, which, as I said, is not part of the fast. But it can denote also that there is a small blockage in one of the blood vessels. But it's these areas of the brain which have vague presentation. Like some people can be a little bit confused. Some people have memory loss, can get what we call vacant episodes, like they lose not consciousness, but you feel they are staring to something and they are not with you, you know?
And I guess a lot of it is it's beholden on all of us, and indeed for us to watch our relatives and family and friends, is that if anything's slightly wrong, for goodness sake, just go and see someone, talk to your GP, and, you know, just get their help and guidance, if nothing else, for their peace of mind.
True. And I think in the beginning, the diabetes, the high blood pressure, all that need to be corrected strictly. And people have to, as I said, be aware that they might develop this disease, so they have to go to their GP more frequent.
Well, we'll talk a little bit more about this later, but it's really fascinating, so thank you very much. But it's now time for a short break. But when we return, we'll be answering your questions. So don't go anywhere. We'll be right back. Welcome back to The Health Show, where our topic today is strokes. Now, the phone lines are open, and the number to call is 020 7374 6423, and you can also email us at healthshow@islamchannel.tv. Once again, we must stress that should you suffer from any medical problems, it's always highly recommended that you contact your doctor or GP, as The Health Show gives you an alternative viewpoint to the health concern being discussed. And that's really, really important in all the things we've been talking about today. But just before we take your calls, let's introduce our Ask the Pharmacist segment again, where our qualified pharmacist, Nadia Bukhari, gives advice on how to get the information you need from your local pharmacist regarding the topic we've been discussing today.
Hi, it's Nadia, your pharmacist. Medical emergencies need to be dealt with immediately in A&E, as discussed on today's show. However, a pharmacist may help if you instantly need medication. If you urgently need medication, contact your prescriber to arrange a prescription. If this isn't possible, you may be able to get your medicine from a pharmacist in an emergency, subject to certain conditions. You must have been prescribed the medicine before by a doctor, dentist, nurse prescriber, optometrist independent prescriber, or any other healthcare professional who is registered in the UK. In addition to this, the pharmacist will usually need to see you face to face, must agree that you need the medication immediately, will usually need evidence that you've been prescribed that medicine before, must be satisfied with the dose that is most appropriate for you to take. The pharmacist may provide an emergency supply of up to 30 days treatment for most prescription medicines, with these exceptions: insulin, an ointment, a cream, or an asthma inhaler. The smallest pack size is given. The contraceptive pill, a full treatment cycle, will be given. Liquid or oral antibiotics, the smallest quantity to provide a full course treatment. Permitted controlled drug medicines, up to 5 days treatment. Permitted controlled medicines include very limited range of medicines, such as those for epilepsy, for example, phenobarbital. Many commonly used controlled medicines, such as morphine or dimorphine, can't be supplied without a prescription by a pharmacist in an emergency. The pharmacist will then make a note in their prescription book of your name and address, the nature of the emergency, the date of the emergency supply, the name, quantity, form, for example, capsules or tablets, and strength of the medicine. Even if the pharmacist is unable to give you an emergency supply of a medicine, they will advise you on how to obtain any essential medical care that you may need. Supplying medicine in an emergency is a private service that is not funded by the NHS, meaning that the pharmacist can charge for it. The charge will vary depending on the medicine and the pharmacist's policy. You may be able to get your medicine or a prescription in one of the following ways: seeing a local GP and asking for prescription. Staff at an NHS walk-in centre may be able to arrange for you to see a GP. Asking a local pharmacist if they can provide an emergency supply of your medicine. And in some cases, a nurse at an NHS walk-in centre may be able to supply your medicine or a prescription. Outside normal GP hours, you may be able to get a prescription from an out-of-hours service. If you're a visitor to the UK, you may be able to get an emergency supply of a medicine from a pharmacist. At your request, if there is an evidence that a doctor or a dentist registered in a European Economic Area, or the EEA country, or Switzerland, has prescribed the medicine for you before, at the request of a doctor or dentist registered in the EEA or Switzerland, if you have a valid prescription from a doctor or dentist registered in the EEA. However, this arrangement is not applicable to medicines prescribed by other EEA or Swiss healthcare professionals, such as nurses, and it doesn't apply to all medicines. For example, pharmacists can't provide emergency supply of controlled medicines, medicines that don't have a UK marketing authorisation. In addition to this, the pharmacist may not be able to provide an emergency supply of the medication if the prescription is written in a language that they can't understand. It is illegal for pharmacists to supply medicines based on prescriptions issued outside the UK, the EEA or Switzerland. This includes prescriptions issued by doctors in the US and Canada. In cases of emergencies, we may be able to provide you with your medicines. Please visit your pharmacist for more information.
Thanks very much indeed, Nadia. Fantastic tips and helpful advice there, as always. And the pharmacist is a great source of information for you. Now, as we said before, Nadia, the phone lines are now open. So please do give us a call if you'd like to talk about anything associated with strokes. The number is 020 7374 6423. I'll repeat that again. It's 020 7374 6423, and you can also email us your questions at healthshow@islamchannel.tv. So get dialing. We'd love to answer any of your questions. And again, we heard there about the pharmacist's role. And again, I'm guessing they can be more and more involved with when people are concerned about symptoms that they might have, that we were talking about before the break there, of very mild strokes or very mild symptoms that are starting to present themselves.
Sure. I suggest if someone is near a pharmacy, they can go and ask the pharmacist about their symptoms. If they just have slight drop of the face, or you know, a bit of slurring of speech, or they feel a bit confused, they might be able to help them. But as I said, the CT scan is the mainstay of treatment. Once they have the diagnosis confirmed, they have to be on aspirin, which maybe pharmacy can supply them with that. Because they need to be on a slightly higher dose of aspirin that the baby aspirin people tend to take with, you know, the heart problems and the high blood pressure.
Now, one of the things that I know we talked a little bit about before, just while we wait for some phone calls to come in, is a lot of people will be watching and they have a relative who is just not going to the doctor, who should go to the doctor. Right. What would you say to them? What sort of advice would you give to someone who says, I'm trying to convince my mother, my father, my grandparents to go and they won't go?
I think it's a must to have a checkup every 6 months at the GP, or what we call like MOT.
Yeah.
So same to the car, you know, we are a machine and this machine can break down at any time. If we don't really notice what's going on, or we don't predict, then that can affect our health later. And I really feel so sorry to see patients who are young in age, or, you know, now the age is quite different than before. Like people at 70, they are still very active in the community. They do everything they want. They can still work. They travel. So why do we have get them to be disabled, yeah. you know?
Get help, for goodness sake. And we actually have our first caller on the line. So a very good afternoon. Perhaps you could tell us who you are and where you're from, and we'll be delighted to answer your question.
Hi, I'm Amina from London, and I have a question for the doctor. I wanted to ask, is there a certain age that people, which is popular for people to get strokes, and should the younger generation, is it something that they should be concerned about, or should they have any knowledge on it? What's the popular age for it?
That's a great question, because a lot of people, and you were touching on that, that it's actually happening younger and younger. So at what point, at what age roughly, should people be starting to be more aware of it in themselves? Mm. Obviously, watch your relatives, but for yourselves, what sort of age would you say?
It's commonly above 50 or above 40, depending actually on the risk conditions people have. So if people now started to develop type 2 diabetes, especially because of bad health habits, bad eating, becoming obese, so now we see diseases which were diseases of old age only coming to a younger age. But still, some young patients can have strokes, but it's a very rare condition, especially if they have some congenital diseases in the heart, where there is like a hole in the heart that can cause a clot going to the brain. But obviously, we don't normally see people in their 20s or 30s, you know, with stroke.
So a lot of it is down to your lifestyle. And if you're someone who is eating reasonably healthy, you're not obese, you're not smoking, for someone like that, it shouldn't really be an issue till what sort of age?
I think up to the age of 50, hopefully we're safe.
Right, okay. So up until 50, but then after 50, just have that increased awareness of your own body.
Yes, of course. And before, they used to like advise people to take aspirin, the small aspirin, you know, over the counter. I don't advise them to do that unless they have a very high risk factor for developing stroke. As I said, the common diseases, obesity, high blood pressure, diabetes, or ischemic heart disease, or they have a high family history of having these conditions.
Yeah, I'd like to talk about that in just one second. Just to remind everybody to please do call in if you'd like any information about strokes, and we'll come to the hereditary side in just one moment. But we've got another caller. A very good afternoon. Could you tell us who you are, where you're calling from today, please?
Hi, it's V from London. I had a question for the doctor. Is slurring of speech permanent when you have a stroke?
So she was talking about slurring of speech, which is we often associate with being a stroke. We did touch on that a little bit before. She's asking whether it's permanent. What are the chances of you being able to solve that issue?
A lot of people improve as the blood supply improves through the brain. So hopefully when they take the aspirin, they take cholesterol tablets after the stroke, and that helps the blood vessels, which were really blocked, to open up. And then the brain has the ability to regenerate. So a lot of brain cells can, after death, actually some of the brain cells can overtake the dead ones, which is a blessing from God, alhamdulillah, is to start building new brain cells. So we see a lot of patients who were not able to talk in the beginning, and they start to talk later on. And also the other factor which affects that or controls really speech is where the stroke happened. So if it happened in the frontal part of the brain, it's slightly difficult to get the speech back as in the back of the brain.
Okay, very good. And again, I haven't forgotten the hereditary thing. We'll come to that, but I just want to take as many calls as we can. And please do keep on calling in if you'd like to. We'd love to hear from you. We have our next caller. Good afternoon. What would you like to ask
our
doctor?
I've got two questions for you. First of all, the first one is, what can you do to reduce your risk of stroke? And the second one is, why is there a need to act fast during a stroke?
So what can we do to prevent a stroke? Yeah. And this, we talked a lot about the speed of dealing with it. Why is it so important?
Right. So to prevent stroke, as I said, healthy lifestyle, exercise, healthy food, Try to walk, even if you can't go to the gym. Avoid, you know, going in your car all the time. I think even walking every day for half an hour is enough to help you, you know, get your circulation better and improve the blood supply to the brain and the heart. So it's mainly prevention. But regarding the speed, if, as I said, brain is time or time is brain, which means if we kill more brain cells, it's a bit difficult to get them back. So that's why once the patient has the symptoms, they have to call the ambulance immediately, get them to the hospital quickly.
Because every moment that's delayed, the condition will have more long-lasting effect.
Yeah. I think they say for each minute you kill about a million brain cells, which is quite a lot.
Wow.
But we have millions and millions of brain cells.
But well, some more than others, but that's another topic for another time.
We don't want to kill them all.
Very quickly, just before we take our next call, I just want to talk a little bit about the hereditary factors. If you have a relative who's had a stroke or had heart disease and things like that, what increase of chance does that present for yourself to get some form of stroke?
Yeah, it's mainly like direct family members, so not like nieces, nephews or uncles. It's if your parents really had a stroke at the age of 50 or 60, you have a very high risk to develop vascular disease because it really runs in the family. So I would suggest, if I know that my mom or my dad, you know, have this condition, that I should go for a checkup quicker in life, like in the 30s. I should go to my GP and do health check, like check my blood pressure, diabetes, and make sure that I'm also eating healthy food and keep fit all the time. Sometimes it's inevitable and you can't really prevent it. If someone knows that a close family member had the stroke at the age of 50, a lot of people can develop that as well in the same age. So I would suggest if they have any of the conditions which are hereditary, like diabetes or high blood pressure, to start on aspirin, the small aspirin, the 75 milligrams, just to guard against developing these conditions. But in this age, we don't suggest scans unless people develop the mini stroke. So not everyone will go for a scan. Because people get really terrified about that. And every time we make awareness of stroke, you find a lot of people come to the hospital asking for a scan of the neck, but we don't do that.
And again, just in case viewers have just watched, could you just repeat the difference between a mini stroke and a full stroke? First of all, in terms of the symptoms that they present, and secondly, in terms of the action that we should take.
So the symptoms of the mini stroke are still the fast symptoms, but they improve within the hour. Like they might be very severe in the beginning with severe weakness, facial drop, slurring of speech, but after an hour they nearly disappear or they become less, while the stroke actually gets worse by time because, as you say, we kill more brain cells.
And I'm guessing there's no way of determining when that immediate, you know, let's hope that when someone suffers from a stroke, whether it be mini or full stroke, that there's somebody there to witness it.
That's why they have to call the ambulance. When they come to the hospital, if we note that they improve, we don't really give them the clot-busting treatment. We just give them aspirin without giving the thrombolysis, because we know that this is going to be a transient ischemic attack rather than a stroke.
Okay, we actually just had an email. Unfortunately, I don't know who you are, but they're calling from London. They're just asking about what is it that in medical advances that you were talking there about this almost like a miracle. What is it that we've been able to develop to increase our chances of surviving a stroke?
So having the thrombolysis, that was the new advancement, which has been now in a lot of tertiary centres in the UK. As I said, it's not every hospital can provide this treatment because it needs a special monitoring after giving this injection. It is quite a strong injection, and you have to monitor blood pressure. It can cause a bleed later on in the brain if we don't really monitor patients closely. So it needs a center which has 24-hour care of radiology, MRI, and neurosurgeons. I mean, you need really a specialized center.
And again, if you call 999, they will know where to send you, which is why identifying the fact that it's a stroke as opposed to any other condition is really, really important.
Correct. And that's why you have the air ambulance to take you to the specialist center. The new development, which has been introduced now in the UK, but unfortunately it's not quite common everywhere now, is to take the clot out of the brain. And this is like, you know, when people have the heart attacks before, they used to give the same injection we give now to the brain, and we learned that from the heart people. But they become more specialized now in taking out the clot. So now the first line therapy in anyone with a heart attack is to take the clot out or do what we call angiogram and take the clot out of the heart. They are in the way now to do the same thing in the brain. But as I said, it's only like two or three centers in the whole UK which do
that.
How are we
in compared to the rest of the world and other countries in terms of how we deal with strokes? We're always hearing that in Britain we have just incredible medical advances, and the, you know, when it comes to the science and medical facilities, you know, in Britain it really is next to none. Where do we stand in the world rankings in terms of our research and how much we know about strokes?
I think we're doing very well. Like when I used to work in Wolverhampton before, it was a hyper-acute stroke service there, and the number of patients we cured and we have seen and they improved was marvelous compared to the European centres. So,
well, it's great to hear that, because we do a fantastic job. Thank you so much indeed. Well, there you have it. We've run out of time already, but some valuable information there on keeping your heart and, of course, your body healthy to help prevent a stroke. Now, I'd like to thank our guest today, Dr. Nihal Abosaif, for coming to the studio and for enlightening us. Thank you for watching at home and for those of you who called in as well. If you've got any more questions, please do give us a call, or for that matter, you can actually email us as well for this topic or any of the topics we've covered in the series. Our email address is healthshow@islamchannel.tv. Now, join me next time when we'll be joined by Dr. Henna Khan, and we'll be talking about women's sexual health. So thank you very much indeed again for watching. Goodbye for now. Assalamu alaikum.